NHS and they're left to the local authority in the same way as it would be if it had happened to you or I or Mitch or Steve, where we had this illness simply because of unfortunate circumstances, metaphysically or biologically or whatever you want to call it, you know. But the speed of the ball, I mean, that's a fascinating one. It's something I've never ever heard before, and I'd be interested in what Mitch's opinion on is it, you know, especially from a medical side.
Different types of impact, Steve.
Yeah.
And this is the thing, when you look at brain injury, what you've got to think of is your brain's a jelly in a box. And if you slap that box, that jelly wobbles and that causes damage. That's the basis of concussion for starters. And if you were to have a jelly in a box and give the box a slap, look how long it reverberates for after you've slapped it. And that's part of the problem with brain injury. And it's why I've been involved in this study, looking at American football and mouth guard use as part of the concussion protocols. Is does a mouth guard, a properly fitted mouth guard, reduce concussion? Because the theory is, if you get tackled playing American football, that's your first impact. Your second impact is you hitting the ground. And then your third impact is your teeth clattering against each other and jamming your jaw into the base of your skull and giving a third impact onto the brain while it's already wobbling like hell. And so they're looking at ways that to stop that. Potentially, that could be the difference between you getting a concussion or not. Speed of impact is something else that probably creates a different type of impact injury. For me, we need really good data. The first thing we need is to say, right, we've got all these football teams with all these players who are getting dementia. As humans, we are programmed to look for patterns. We'll look for patterns in numbers. And actually, part of true randomness are patterns. And so we sometimes assign patterns to things that we just shouldn't assign to. So the first thing we need to ascertain is, are these numbers within these teams significantly different statistically to the general population of people who get dementia? And that's the first port of call. And that's probably the most easiest one to do. To say, right, are these guys now at a higher risk of dementia before you start looking at why? Then you come to the why. Is it speed of impact? Is it type of impact? Is it the ball type? Is it whatever? I tell you why they should get interested in it, though, as a body, both the FA, the PFA, UEFA, FIFA. Bearing in mind, I've spoken at a FIFA medical conference, and I know how hard it is to get them interested in anything. It's super hard, unless you're one of their relatives or you've got a ton of cash in your back pocket. I'm sorry, but that's the reality. And so we need to get them interested, because if you look at rugby union at the moment, there's currently a class action being made against various rugby football unions by former players. One of them, Steve Thompson, World Cup winner, who claims he can't remember any one of his games in the World Cup he won.
Wow.
Can't remember any of them.
And that was 2003.
And you've got a 41-year-old ex Welsh international flanker who has early onset dementia. And if you look at some of the games he's played where he's taken severe blows to the head and played on, that needs investigated. A lot of these things are super complicated. I look at something like, and obviously, as you guys know, I have a very personal interest in something like Alzheimer's, and I know there's actually dental links to Alzheimer's from my job, is that there's a statistical link between active gum disease and Alzheimer's disease, and it's all about inflammation. So there's another complication. Are these guys more prone to brain injuries of a different type because of other injuries or conditions they pick up in their day-to-day training, injuries, playing, what have you? Some of these things are super complex. and it really does need filtered out. But for me, the first protocol has got to be, let's look at the data in terms of general population versus professional footballers. And if there's a statistically significant increase, and I know it certainly sounds like there is anecdotally without actually having statistics with active P numbers that prove it. And certainly if you were to push me on it, I'd say, yeah, there's something going there that we really have to investigate rather urgently. Because why are American football doing so much about concussion at the minute? Because they're waiting to be hammered by a load of class action lawsuits. Yeah. Why are the Rugby Football Union now jumpy? Because there's a class action lawsuit coming. And there'll be a big one from the professional footballers eventually. And everybody in football, including the PFA, who've done absolutely nothing about it, and don't even seem like they care, they could be on the receiving end of it too, because you didn't look after our players. And so, you know, it's something we really need to look at. The other factor that everybody's talking about is it because you're introducing heading too young? Do you introduce heading above a certain age or below a certain age? And because young development brains are very different than mature adult brains in terms of how they suffer injury and also how they recover from injury. And again, I've got another personal reason to be interested in that, and having seen how somebody I know recovered from a brain condition almost like magic when he was given the right treatment.
Yeah, good stuff.
And I think if I was given that treatment, I wouldn't recover that way because I'm nearly 50.
Yeah.
But you know, and so these things are never simple. They're never black and white. There's so much gray in there. And what we'll have to do is have a dedicated team of people who know where they're at in terms of a medical position, know where they're at in terms of statistical and research position, and devise a set of parameters whereby they analyze all of this and start to filter some of the stuff out, so it becomes easier to come to a definitive conclusion that says, this is statistically totally right, this is what's going on, and this is how we need to combat it. Because these things are so emotive. Dementia, such an emotive thing. Watching somebody disappear in front of your eyes while they're still living and breathing must be one of the hardest things to watch. Must be one of the hardest things to live with day in, day out. And no wonder it's emotive.
Yeah.
And again, you guys know where I'm coming from on that one. Yeah. We need the data. We need the data. And we need somebody within football to be interested enough in getting that data. And that's where it's falling down for me at the moment.
I think what we also need to do is we need to make sure that we don't get deflected from football by the comparisons to other sports. We mentioned boxing right at the start, Steve, and you know as well as I do in boxing that boxers, the majority of time in training, are protecting themselves or are doing training in a particular way, and even if they're wearing a head guard, they're very rarely getting punched in the head continuously. Unlike the footballer who is spending potentially hours and hours on the football pitch every week in training, heading the football, totally unprotected. So the whole idea of boxing is to avoid having your head hit.
Yes.
It's not to be hitting the head, you know.
That kind of loses your fights, really. Yes.
Right. You're also you're being hit by someone wearing a 12-ounce glove, and you're avoiding it, and you're moving and being hit at the same time. But it's only in the fight itself, in the majority of times, that you're getting hit in the head. Whereas the footballer, it's 6 days a week in training, 2 hours a day, running around, heading the ball continuously, practicing with defending corners, defending free kicks, attacking free kicks, attacking corners. So we shouldn't, whatever happens, they've got to make sure that they don't try and just run comparisons and hide behind another sport, whether it's football, whether it's rugby, boxing, American football, or any other sport where head injuries. I read even a young girl who was in a not a bobsleigh, but one of those, down on the tea tray, sliding down a track, and she suffers from a brain injury, sustained because she actually lifted her head 2 centimeters higher